So that's a big barrier for many of our people that don't speak other languages like English or others. So we decided to create this space in the IGF to promote the use and the creation of content in Spanish, in Portuguese. We have Vanessa that she's doing an amazing work in generating content in Portuguese in Brazil. She has joined us for several years as well. And we have other friends as panelists. I will briefly name them. Some are with us now and some are remote. We have by my side my friend Ricardo Pedraza from VeriSign. Remote, we have Vanessa Fusco Nogueira. She's from the Ministry of Justice in Minas Gerais, Brazil. We have Nacho Amados from .cat in Barcelona, in Spain. He's remote participating. We have Jesus Jimenez Segura and his staff from Instituto Cervantes in Spain. And here we have Gorka Urueta from the University of País Vasco. Yeah, that's the name, okay. And we have Adrián Carballo. He works with me in the South School of Internet Governance, and myself, Olga Cavalli. And am I forgetting someone? No, that's okay. And we have some friends, Fatima, Sala, other friends in Hugo, and other friends in the room. Thank you for joining us. I will switch to Spanish. Bueno, gracias a todos. No voy a hablar más yo. Yo no soy la estrella son todos ustedes. Así que me encantaría, Jesús, si te damos el piso a ti y ustedes comienzan. Gorka, ¿estamos para ellos? ¿Sí? Que hable Jesús, me dice Gorka, que es nuestro... No, Jesús, Gorka es nuestro master switch remoto. Así que, Jesús, te escuchamos y te vemos. Sí, por supuesto, si pueden hacerlo o si quieren... A ver, ahí estamos con el técnico haciendo... no me lo mando por mail. Ahí está. Listo. Vanessa, yo hablo portugués, pero te escuchamos muy bien y te seguimos. Y salvo un minuto que se interrumpió un poco la presentación, te seguimos perfectamente. Y realmente tu trabajo me parece muy interesante. Así que quédate en línea en el caso que haya alguna pregunta. Nos quedan tres oradores. Nos queda Ricardo, nos queda Gorka y Andrés. Tenemos 23 minutos para dividirlos entre los tres. Así que Ricardo... Así que, bueno, pero lo vamos a dejar a Ricardo, que pacientemente nos ha acompañado, y también Gorka, y después te doy 5 minutos, Andrés, para el final. Listo. Hacemos así. Ricardo, todo tuyo.
Bueno, mucho gusto. Buenos días o buenas noches, dependiendo de a quién estemos escuchando. Primero que todo, quiero pedirles disculpas porque voy a cambiar a inglés, dándole... otro enfoque y una perspectiva que van a ver un poco internacional a nuestro tema de preservar las lenguas nativas y también por respeto a Sala, que está de aquí de Fiji, y a Keisha de Trinidad y Tobago. So, as I told you, let me bring an international perspective to this discussion of preserving native languages. I've been this year really honored to participate at the Pacific Island IGF in New Caledonia and at the Caribbean IGF in Trinidad Tobago. Therefore, I'm very pleased to see Sala from Fiji and Keisha from Trinidad Tobago attending today this session. And but let me bring us back to the Pacific Island. There are over 20 to 30,000 islands scattered through the Pacific Ocean. And these islands are traditionally grouped in what we call, well, we call Oceania. And there's three divisions in Oceania, Melanesia, Micronesia, Polynesia. Another group in bringing these thousands of islands to over 40 countries and territories. And what is really interesting to see, and let me share my experience when I was attending the Pacific Island IGF, is that I started to talk to different people among the audience, and each time I asked, well, where do you come from? They say, well, I come from Vanuatu, I come from America, Samoa, I come from this island or this other. I ask, well, you know, how many people does you have there? What's the population? Say, well, 10,000, 100, depending on the size. But, and how many languages do you speak? Well, there were dozens, from dozens to hundreds of different languages. And I was, what? Maybe I'm not hearing well. You said it was 100 different languages? Yes. 100 different languages for 100,000 inhabitants? Yes. Wow. And that just bring me my curiosity and my interest on trying to understand and know better the historical and social living there. And the language, in fact, have been passed down orally through years and years. They journeyed from Africa through Asia, and finally they get into the Pacific Ocean. And what you have the opportunity, what I do, I have the opportunity to see this, the people which got settled there in these islands are just wonderful. They have a tremendous and extraordinary love for nature, a sense of caring of each other that is just, I believe, an example to the world. And a tremendous also language richness. And I really wonder, and that's part of what I'm bringing here to this scenario is, how much how they realize this is a richness. It's not a weakness. This is a really richness they have, and it's completely different from any part, other part of the world. The challenge, or one of the challenge, is to keep it this linguistic value through the times. I learned from some of the research I did with Sala Help that they have discovered that at some schools in some of this country, they don't allow to speak the kids in their native language. They are forced in some way to speak their official languages. And that's really sad. Because the only way they have to learn and to preserve this native language is by talking. And kids talk to their parents in their native languages, but at the school they are not able to share this kind of type of communication with their friends. So that's something that I'm not going to cover here. But maybe another challenge I want to bring to the table is the fact that there is no local content in the in internet content on these native languages, and so access to internet becomes more critical than ever, because it will be the perfect tool to preserve this native language and to share this knowledge and this richness that they have inherited through so many, many years. I have the great opportunity the last week to visit the Masai Mara Park National Reserve, and you have for sure heard that it's amazing. It's just beautiful, and it's again it's a part of the world that has been almost not touched by civilization. And in fact, when I think about that and try to relate to this, is a set of policies, of rules, and actions has been taken to make that possible, to preserve this beauty of the nature possible. So the question I want to share with you is, why should be not possible to do the same thing with these ancestral languages? And that's my presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. That was very interesting, and it's nice how this space is broadened, because we started with Spanish, then Vanessa came with her ideas in Portuguese. Then we had, not this year, unfortunately, people from Microsoft brought their developments in Native American languages, in Aymara, Quechua, and other things. And now you bring this Pacific perspective. So we are getting global with this idea, and I like it very much. And I like that Sala and her friend could follow us, because I was so ashamed that you couldn't follow. But you know, I love you so much. So we both share this feeling. Should we switch to Spanish, Gorka, or you're fine with English? Whatever you want. This is a diverse space. Or you, if you do it in euskera, I will not follow you. I'm sorry, but
I guess nobody will follow me.
But you have your right.
Yeah, of course, but I
would,
the presentation is in English,
so
but I will speak in Spanish.
Would you do that in English? So maybe Sala can follow you? And so we are all bilingual here, right? Yes, please. Yeah, go ahead. How do you want to manage the PowerPoint? You want me to help you?
That could be great.
Okay.
Maybe. So I will do, well, my name is Gorka Orueta. I came from the University of the West Country, that is in Bilbao, in the north part of Spain. And this was the first time that I've been doing like a short presentation about the language that we speak, that is not a Latin language, it is a native language. I will do a short presentation, what is the Basque and how we are using, or how we are getting into the internet. We are doing some really nice efforts, and go ahead. Just to know where we are just in Europe, the north part of Spain, between Spain and between Spain and France. So we are like 2,155,000 people in inhabitants. It is 6% of the Spanish population, but we share also our language and our culture with a huge diaspora community that it went to the Americas on the 19th and the 20th century, mostly to the United States, but plenty of them in Argentina, where is a really huge Basque community there, Chile, Mexico, Venezuela, Cuba. So we can say that almost 18 million people share the Basque language, or at least the culture. Maybe you will know many people that they have a Basque last name or family name that they don't know. But also the Basque language, it is not just one. There are like five dialects and 11 sub or under dialects. So the name of our language is Euskera, but then you can read that the name of the language, it is said of many different ways, it depends on the part. So that we are not a, just, a, we are a like I said, language, but it is very rich because the dialects. Okay. About the numbers, how many people is getting to the internet? Well, we are just in the average of the European Union, so at least the 66% of the people getting to the internet. But what it is interesting here is to know which is the language if they are using Basque to get in the internet, and the almost 23% uses Basque as the first language in the net. That, okay, it is no less people for us. The number of the internet users has doubled in the last 10 years, and of course the biggest increase has been in young people. So as in all the surveys that have been made, young people is the future for the internet users, I get. So they mainly are looking for web information, cultural contents, and music. So go ahead, please, Olga. In the Basque area, we have a plan for the promotion and use of the euskera. That is an analysis of the vitality of the language, of the Basque language. And it puts like, it's a broad plan with three strategic targets. One is the transference of the language that accomplishes the teaching, the adult literacy, and the Basque language transference within the family. The social use, where this this plan also includes the use of the ICT, also the internet, and the quality of the language, the preservation of the quality of the language. But as we can see, the information and communication technologies and the internet is a cross-cutting factor that affects also in the transference, in the social use, and the quality of the on the language. About the transference, the first, we can go ahead. Yep. No, we move to, one list. Up. Another one? Another, no, más atrás. Una más atrás. Ay, no, nos fuimos. No? Well, okay. Well, about the, no, the, this, you're moving forward. You have to go back like three slides. No, another one? That's okay, we got it. So the transfer entity accomplishes the teaching and the adult literacy and the transfer of the language within the families. Well, what is interesting for us is how is the promotion of the language in the schools and also in the adult literacy. And they have developed many applications. Some of them, I put just the icons just you to know, the Escola 2.0 or the Click 2.0. There are some applications where based in Basque language that they use the students, the kids in their learning process. But also, and they have been developed many web portals that they offer to learn the language on the internet, like casten.net, Ator, By and By, there's a private company, or the Mondragon Lingua, or Aritu, they are, so Boga, also there are some experiences where people from all the world, they can start learning Basque. Go ahead now. To improve the social use of the Basque, there have been many campaigns, and one since 2005, it has been Browsing in Basque, Navigatu Euskeraz, and they have been translated the most popular web browsers to the Basque language, but also in using the ICT and the mobile phones, because the mobile phones are becoming very useful devices for getting into the internet. Okay, there's an arrangement because the Basque regional government with some companies, some mobile manufacturers, but also with the ISPs, the internet service and mobile providers, like Euskaltel, Movistar, another one, to offer these services in Basque language. So that has been since 3-4 years ago, an innovation, and there now many people can use their device in Basque language. That maybe for the Spanish people it's something that is usual, but in Basque it has not been. We can go ahead. Yeah. And about the third target, the quality of the language, there have been developed many, many tools in Basque language, like dictionaries or dictionaries of terminology, legal, commerce, administration, or journalism. All of them that you can see that the small icons are services that people can connect and use just to translate, to make translation from Basque to English, of course, to French, to French, to Polish, to Russian. And there are also more specific dictionaries or grammar and orthography checkers that we can use. And I do use them because I teach in Basque language. So there are really, it helps us a lot when we are writing, when we are using our language. Now, for many people in the Basque area that they work in Basque language, we are using this kind of tools to preserve or to keep the quality of the language we are using. So it has been a really good step. And the other one, please. And there are also, it has been developed or translated many software resources. Many of them, I guess you understand, you recognize, like the Messenger or the WordPress for blogging, or the Open Office, the Windows, the Microsoft Office is also in Basque language, or the Emule and the Internet Explorer. Okay, the Android, it's also been translated to Basque language. So the effort is being, in a part, supported by the Basque government, but there's also a vibrant internet community that uses the Basque, and they did a really huge job translating, for example, the Open Office and all the free software, many free software programs. And now, like Firefox and another one, they are available in Basque language to be used. And since 2009, there's a foundation called Azkue Foundation, that the aim of this foundation is to promote specifically the use of the Basque language on the internet. And of course, the key institutions are involved in this new project, like the University of the Basque Country and the University of Deusto, the Town Hall, and also the Royal Academy of the Basque Language. And they used to focus on young Basque speakers in an open and participatory environment. So all the projects that they are doing, they had as a first target the young Basque speaker, because as we saw in the survey, they are the more internet users and they are digital natives. They get all the new devices, all the new applications they learn, they know how they use, and sometimes it's not my case. So we can move again. One of the effort is the creation of content, the develop of content, and also in the Creative Commons. In the list of the Wikipedias, we can find the Wikipedia in Basque language, that it is in the 36 ranking, with more than 100,000 articles. It has been a really hard effort, and it's growing up. And to motivate the production of more articles, you can read in the screen, Iñaki Ugarteburu Saria, that means an award for articles made in a university level. So it is the second edition. It has been so they want to the aim is to promote the production of articles in Basque language, but with the university level. I mean, no articles that anybody can read. So then we are in the 36th ranking of the in the list of the Wikipedias that I will remark that he has been a really, really good effort, and he's growing up because there's a community behind, and there's also motivating that community. And going ahead. Well, so for finishing, what is, I think, the challenge for the Basque in the near future? I think first we have to continue improving the study and the survey, and the survey of the use of the Basque on the internet. Where do people access, and which is the device are using? Because I think things are changing so fast, and if you would like to have a clear picture about what is Basque, which is the use of the Basque language, we should do that. And of course, we should focus on the applications to reach the digital natives. And right now, it are social networks. The way to get young internet users that they already know Basque, but they are not using Basque, through the social networks we can reach them. And of course, another challenge that I think is really important is to adapt the language, but also all the content that has been produced to the new forms of communication, like social networks, but also to the new devices. Now we are leaving the tablet area too, so we should adapt our contents to the new devices. And the day before yesterday was the European Day of the Cultures, and the day before yesterday there was announced that a foundation that is working on Basque and new technologies, they present some 5 dictionaries for the iPhone and the Android. So now we can use this kind of tools that, they are, as I told you before, they are really useful in iPhones and also in Android phones. And to summarize a bit and to link what Nacho was talking us about the .cat, I do really think that there's also a huge community, Basque community, and I think the new TLD.eu that could improve much more the presence and the use of the Basque on the internet. I had some word, a sentence that it was from the UNESCO, that I can read it in Spanish. Los idiomas no son herramientas de comunicación, también representan una visión del mundo. Los idiomas son vehículos para la transmisión de sistemas de valores y expresiones culturales y son un componente esencial del patrimonio vivo de la humanidad. Sin embargo, muchos de ellos están en peligro de extinción. I think that it's we are aware about it. I would like to thank Olga for the workshop, because you are aware also about that situation of many languages that are Latin and also are natives, and that's good for me. Well, we can finish. Asante sana, that means thank you in Swahili, and eskerri kasko, that is in my own language, that is thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I think I totally agree with Gorka and with Ricardo. I think internet is fantastic for preserving this magnificent languages that we have. And it's both global and very narrow cultural, that so they can live together. So I like this workshop because I learned so much. Every year I learned so much from you. And last but not least, I would like to give the floor to Andres, because I think LACNIC has a fantastic role in managing our IP addresses for the region, but the good thing about them is that they do all their work in 3 languages. So Andres, could you brief us a little bit, because people is hungry and we want to for lunch. And thank you for your patience. I know you waited a long for your speech, but I think I like very much all the work that LACNIC does, because it's really multilingual. And in a region like Latin America, where Spanish, it's the main ruling language, that's the main effort. And I really think that's something very important that you do and for our community.
Okay, thank you very much, Olga. I had the impulse of speaking in English because of the record. It stays in the record, and this is huge because you can check again the session and what have been said. But I think speaking Spanish is better at this context in the IGF, where Spanish is a minority and it's my native language, so I will do that. Muchas gracias por la presentación, Olga. La CNIC, además de ser una organización que tiene el Registro Regional de América Latina y Caribe de direcciones IP y de recursos, en realidad, digamos, en su misión está la de promover el desarrollo interno de la región y aquellas iniciativas que contribuyan a ello, y la mayoría de nuestros esfuerzos la ponemos no solo en cumplir esta función técnica de la administración de los recursos críticos de Internet, sino en promover el desarrollo de Internet en la región. Y por ejemplo, en este IGF de Kenia hay 5 becarios de los premios Frida que están participando y que fueron es una de las iniciativas del ACNIC junto con otras organizaciones, y como el IDRC y la Internet Society, y también el evento de la reunión preparatoria del IGF, la reunión regional de la América Latina y Caribe, que tiene 3 becarios en esta reunión y que, digamos, también es una iniciativa de otras organizaciones y nuestra. Nuestro trabajo, tanto en el desarrollo de las políticas, el proceso de desarrollo de políticas de los 5 registros regionales y en particular del ACNIC, es un proceso abierto, es un foro, una lista de discusión, el foro de políticas, una lista que está en los 3 idiomas y que tiene más de 700, 800, superamos los 800 participantes, abierta, cada uno puede expresarse en pie de igualdad, proponer nuevas políticas, y hay 2 reuniones anuales en las cuales esas políticas son votadas y cada voto de los miembros que están en la sala vale 1. La semana que viene hay una en Buenos Aires. Este proceso de desarrollo de políticas después tiene una etapa, una fase global, pero las políticas regionales se desarrollan abiertamente por los miembros de la comunidad. Y esa lista de correo es trilingüe. De hecho, la CNIC, digamos, originalmente ha sido una organización que hablaba español, portugués e inglés, español principalmente, y los otros 2 como lenguas que había que fortalecer, y hoy es una transición que esperamos haber dado en ser una organización trilingüe que se maneja de esta manera, y que tiene sus contenidos en su sitio web disponible en los 3 idiomas, y que realiza tanto los eventos institucionales como aquellos en donde intentamos promover el desarrollo de Internet de la región junto con otras organizaciones, con la disponibilidad de estas 3 lenguajes. Pero la tensión es al revés que la que se da en el resto del sistema, digamos. Es la tensión de incorporar a la minoría, a la particularidad cultural que tiene el Caribe, a esos 13 territorios del Caribe que forman parte de nuestra región, porque ARIN tiene algunos otros. Y en estos territorios, digamos, hacemos eventos en particular en donde tenemos, ahí sí, mayor predominancia del inglés o incluso el francés incorporado. Tenemos una relación con Brasil también muy estrecha y tenemos mucho énfasis en el portugués. Sin embargo, lo natural en el foro de políticas es que el español prime. Digamos. Las decisiones en el foro de políticas se toman y los textos oficiales son en 3 idiomas, pero las propuestas las hace cada uno en el idioma que elige, y el español tiene una primacía, tiene mayor importancia en este aspecto. No mayor importancia porque lo hayamos definido como una lengua principal, sino simplemente porque es la que más se usa. Puede ser interesante tener en cuenta como una beta regional. De todos modos, nosotros tratamos, digamos, como organización de encauzar permanentemente esta situación de primacía del español y de dar la posibilidad que estén todos los contenidos disponibles en todos los idiomas y de dar la misma capacidad o disponibilidad para que alguien pueda participar de cualquier punto de nuestra vasta región. Sin embargo, era una interesante novedad para comentar, que no es nuevo, la CNIC tiene 10 años, va a cumplir 10 años, y esto ha sido una constante. Hemos evolucionado a ser una organización trilingüe, pero normalmente no pasa que en una región prime las lenguas regionales por sobre el inglés. Entonces, es interesante tener en cuenta eso. Me parece que eso nada más. Muchas gracias.
No, gracias a vos, Andrés. Además, él dio su charla en cordobés, no en español. Es un chiste argentino eso. Bueno, thank you very much, everyone. Gracias a todos. Thanks to our remote participants. They were great, all of them. If you, Jesús, could you send us your presentation so we can share it with the people present and remote here in the room? Gracias Vanessa, gracias Jesús, gracias a Nacho, gracias a la gente presente, a Ricardo, Andrés, Gorka. Thank you to our technicians that were great. We had some difficulties with putting things in shape, but thank you very much. Gracias Casio, gracias Hugo y gracias Fátima y gracias Adrián. Gracias a todos y nos estamos viendo presencial y virtualmente. Gracias.